I must confess that Carrie Anne actually started out to be a song about Marianne Faithfull. She was unbelievably attractive. She was an incredibly sexy woman. But we just didn't have the courage to say Marianne, you know, because it, you know, we would have given away the fact that everybody wanted to make love to Marianne Faithfull, you know. But I have to confess, it started out to be a song of Marianne Faithfull, and we just didn't have the courage to say so. So we made up this girl's name, Carrie Anne. Seemed to work.
We were doing a TV show, and I remember actually going out of the dressing room to go and get something to eat, and when I came back, I could hear these two voices singing something about Carrie Anne, Marianne, Marit Tambourine Man, and this line was being sung. And I thought, that sounds pretty good. I better get in there because I need a piece of that song. So I went in, and Tony and Graham were actually writing this song using, I mean, Tony started using Tambourine Man, and then Graham was saying Marianne. And then it actually got round to Carrie Anne. And when it got to the second verse that they'd written, I jumped in with the middle eight. You're so like a woman to me. Good song, great song. But I got there a little bit too late for the verses.
And then we wanted an interesting solo, because once again, we were always trying to experiment and always trying to do strange things. And we were walking on Regent Street in London, and there was a guy playing steel drums. And Tony Hinton said, you know, that'd make a really great solo.
We got this West Indian guy came in with his pan, but it wasn't in tune with the track. So we had to try and tune it up. So we were banging it with this sort of sledgehammer. He'd have a bang, we'd have a bang. Still wasn't in tune, so we used a little bit of vary speed just to get it into tune, which worked.
We never saw him again afterwards. I have no idea what happened to this guy, but he actually played the solo of Carrie Anne on the steel drums. And when we would do that live, we knew that, you know, the sound was an important part of the record. So what we did was we went into EMI, we went into Abbey Road, Studio 2. We took the count off, the bass part, and the solo, and made a tape of that. So live, bass player would turn down, he would fake still playing the bass, we heard the count, we could keep in rhythm because the bass part was there on the tape, and when the solo came in, it came out of nowhere, and it would blow people's minds.